Okay, getting revved up here for another Telecaster adventure. Let's just see how badly it's fucked up. Well, of course, we have this issue. I hate that. Because I just hate it. It's the stupidest design of an idea that is so unserviceable. Let's see if it actually works right. Right, but, you know, is that really acceptable? Would we go on the road and dance around on the stage with that? Nope. There's your favorite noise, folks. Oh, let's tweak the ever so high-end lavalier microphone that I have there. That is a bunch of junk. Is it me or is everything junk? I think everything is junk. Except maybe this Telecaster. Right. Oh, and the missing knob, which, if there is a hell, there's a huge fishbowl on a table, and every few minutes one of those knobs drops into it. That's what I figure. Okay, let's just see how badly screwed up it is before I unscrew it. So what do we got? Well, the string action is actually on the E string lower than it should be. Everything's a little low. Both E strings are too low. Way too low. I don't know. How bad is the neck bent lead? It's not bad. I looked at it. Just got some fret dents and needs to just be measured out and tweaked out properly. One of these days, I'm gonna color code. I've painted these before and then the paint wears off, so it's just like, it's a futile. Yeah, and the neck is really too straight. String action too low, neck too straight, dents in frets. Goofy thing. I would like to get a hold of the guy and tell him I'd like to replace that with a proper electro socket. I'm gonna do that. Ah, okay, so we shot off a text. And, yeah, we're gonna. Now I've said I'm gonna do that. I think I have one. I always get two or three of those. Let's look at an electro socket and see why we love it. Well, I knew I had three. I found one. That's all that matters. So what happens is, I don't know if you've seen inside how this works. It's a metal clip that you expand with a special tool into the walls of that. What that does is it just fits right in. It's an insert that goes right in there. It's got two nice screws that are angled in out of the way into the body of the guitar. It's done. It's over. Never to come loose. Never to have a problem. Done deal. Anyway, let us I was so rudely interrupted when I noticed that the output jack was outputted. The output jack was jacked, and I was looking for my favorite feeler gauge. Yes, and we did that. The neck is too straight, but that's okay. We're going to take all the frets off it, all the strings off it, and level the frets. God, I'm a knucklehead sometimes. And, you know, before we go nuts with the obvious issues, you may remember from other episodes where it's like, here's what's broke. Okay. Oh, I fixed that. Oh, no, I just discovered there's 8 other things that are broke that I didn't really look at. So I'm just going to give this a little loosen. Oh, well, it turns. It's a little stiff. But, like I said, we're going to fool with that in a minute when I get all the strings off. So I'm looking at, you know, one of the 10 comments out of the 2,000 that happen every day. And I don't know, it was a video about fret leveling and, oh, I was using the notched straight edge to make sure the neck was straight before I leveled the frets, and there was just like a whole big paragraph about everything I was doing wrong. I just sort of tried to read it and went, like, buddy, did you ever see how they built one of these guitars? Right? When they build it, all the frets are installed and they're all leveled with no strings. Then they had strings. I definitely got to do the commenting on comments video, as it has to get done, because there's just too much funny stuff there not to take advantage of. And that's why we're here, right, folks? It's for the fun. It's not about guitars. Guitars own us. We don't own them. So, I am going to tape this guy off. And I'm going to, before I do that, I'm actually going to remove the nut. Ah, we're not even in the movie there. What kind of a director are you, anyway? Director of photography, couldn't fucking direct traffic. Okay, yeah, get that off of there, and then we're gonna tape. Okay, a little tap on each side, very gently, just to try and break the glue joint, and then a little tap from the edge like that. And out it comes. Now see, if this was a Stumac video, I would have to run to the toolbox, put this away, cut the cameras, cut everything, put every tool, and then we'll show you the next step. Just watch those videos. I just crack up so much. Well, it worked out well. Let's throw that in the garbage. I mean, let's keep that safe for later. Cheers, folks. This will fix you up. Okay, so we're into this now. The old leveling machine needs no sticky paper. But sometimes the old sticky paper don't like to come off very good. Very easily. There. Woohoo! Are we having fun yet? My question is, how did the fairly expensive piece of sticky paper end up, I don't want that to be on there, end up in the tape drawer? I'm sure there's some harebrained assistant that has an explanation. I don't care if it hangs over a little bit. I probably could have had it hang over a little bit more, but it's too late. It's just too freaking late. Now what I'd like to do, What I'd like to do, so I'd like to pass this on. I'd like to pass this skill on to some other trustworthy primate. I could get all fancy and get a straight edge out, but what fun would that be? You know? Okay. You see where I'm going with this, right? You see where I'm at with this? Is that I want to roll that back on there so I can use the other half another day? Oh, I don't want to cut that one, you shithead. See, it's like that fucking game Mousetrap. I'm stuck like a rat, like one of those fucking... It is that game Mousetrap. Sticky paper Mousetrap. Yeah, that sort of lost its effectiveness. So, if I'm lucky, I'm really lucky. It will have stayed sticky enough to use. That's 120 in case you didn't see. And then there's 220 on the other side, which I don't know if it's seen better days. I have to look at the new stuff to compare. But don't be afraid. Everything's going to be fine. You wait and see. Okay, let's, just like at the factory, before they actually put a neck on a guitar, it's on a bench like this. Right now we got some backy bonus. That's just groovy. Not to be confused with Dr. Groovy. Groovy Music. There, there's my endorsement for the week. Groovymusic.com. All right. Let's make more dust. My computer needs some more dust to suck in, so here we go. Really not too worried about the treble ends, because those frets are good. We're working towards that end. Look at it go. You can go back and forth, but I like to make a pass and have a look. Make sure I'm not, you know. Especially with the new paper, it will get quite aggressive. That's looking pretty good. It's just a little bit in here. Important to remember too, you don't have to take every little defect out. Like there's a little bit of blue there, but once I put the crown back in, that's going to shave that back another bit. And a tiny little bit of spot leveling is not the end of the world. Mm-hmm. here. Okay, I think we're gonna stop there. A little bit more here. We're almost there. We're almost there. And I realize that I have raved about these files, and I will continue to rave about them. But I'm on my second number medium here, and I'm beginning to realize that they're not really great for relying on any heavy work. I've gone back to the metal crowning file for the heavy cuts. Then we're going to use the diamond guy. And I do believe there is a way to recoat those. Stumac had never acknowledged that. But that's something to look into. But like I said, for now, I've gone back to this guy for the big strokes. And believe me, it does big strokes. And then we'll go over things with the diamond guy after. We've done all the heavy cutting. Okay, you've seen this before. Nothing to see here. Stand by for more fun. Yeah, I'm going to say, while I'm on the topic of things that come to light over time, I think in an attempt to make these last longer, the first quick pass is these, because now I've got a really nice shape, and all this is doing now, instead of really cutting, it's just taking the heavier chatter marks out of the fret. So that's the way I'm rolling from now on. There's still diamonds left. Diamonds are a girl's best friend. And you guys probably can't see.
Or maybe you can.
Are we in the movie? Where's the movie? There's the movie. I can still see the little strip on the top. That is the crown. But that, the metal crowning file, it is a monster. Left me some really nice marks to polish out. Like a beaver got it. Yes, as I was saying, why is there sticky back sandpaper in with the tape? I'm sure this just sounds lovely. Let's get some more condom protection going here. Because I don't want to flap the fender off the end of the guitar. Not that there's a danger of that happening. Okay. And yes, my fingers are just old and freaking tired, folks. Tired. This is why we're going with the flap-tastic method. This is 400 grit. The diamond file was 300 grit. Interesting. The hell? No, it's just... And we just keep flapping and flapping. Flapping and flapping. Also, remember, engineering, it's like math, only louder. Okay, so we'll do a little bit of individual fun here with the, you notice I have put on the hand condoms. Gee whiz, what's that? Oh, that's just dust from the sandpaper. So, stories, right? I get a Facebook message from a fan, and I could look back on the thread and check, but he either said he was from somewhere in New York or New Jersey. Anyway, he got a t-shirt and he's vacationing in California, and he's walking down the street, and walking towards him is another dude with a Dave's World of Fun Stuff t-shirt. What the fuck are the chances of that? Like, seriously. Why? Is this 400? No, it's not 400. It's 800, you idiot. What's this? This is 400. I'm going with a little scrap laying there of 800 from yesterday. I'm going, why aren't the last scratches coming out of there? Doctor fucking scientist. Yeah, what are the chances of that? Taking it into consideration that I only printed 200 t-shirts. So, it's like, one of you nerds out there, get your math on and tell me what the odds of that are. 200 t-shirts shipped worldwide. Two guys from either side of the country run into each other on the street wearing their t-shirts. That one just freaks me, man. That's pretty funny. And I've said this before. Doesn't matter how many times you do this. It's a lot of work. But once it's done and you look at it and you go, why didn't I do that a long time ago? That's usually everybody's real reaction. Why did I let it get so shitty? This wasn't actually that bad. Many have been worse. I can actually measure the frets if we want to see what's there. I'm guessing we might have lost 5 thou out of a possible 10 to 15 that you could use up. I gotta cut some small pieces. Okay, it appears camera is dying of battery. But I'm just going to polish. I'm going to quit after I polish this for a while. Set it up later so I'll have a new battery and then we'll set it up. And that'll be that. Till then. Somebody asked me once, is there anything you can do to make them stay looking like that? And I went, well, other than polishing them every time you change the strings, there's not much. They won't look like that in the day. But they'll look like that for a few hours. Okay, let's put the nut back in. I think I'm just going to clean up the body while the guitar is in bits. It's going to make things easier. Doesn't seem to be too smashed up and abused, except it lost its knobulator. Like I said, think of a fishbowl in hell filled with those. That is gone. I think out of all the things I use the most, it's clean rags. There's no substitute for clean cotton rags from the paint shop. Oh, I just noticed there's an owie, a bubbo, right there. That sucks. But you know what I have? I have some black lacquer and a tiny brush. And just because I'm that kind of guy, there's another one there. Maybe I'm asking too much of myself. Hold on. No, there's two or three little ticks on the guitar. Other than that, it's in pretty good shape. The problem with those sort of things is they just you probably can't even see shit here. They just end up expanding over time. That's my experience. So if you don't care that it's going to get bigger and bigger, because it eventually will. But nowadays most of the stuff is shot with colors you can't really buy over the counter. I was talking about a custom color. A custom color is not one of a kind. It's a color that a company uses to paint their guitars with that I can't go buy at the store. Right? That's a custom color. Just like Ford makes a lot of blue cars. Their blue is a special blue. Think about it. Even these blacks. Like, there's different blacks when you get into it. Look at that. Speaking of black, I told you folks I could only buy black guitars, right? I don't know, is she listening? I only buy black guitars, and when the wife sees them, she just thinks it's one that I had before, because they're all black. While we're on the topic of things we said we'd fix, let's get the right wrench. I just got new glasses too. I think I'll be going back for more new glasses real soon. And of course, oh, there we go. So these things are just so feebly stupid. I guess they must have been cheap. Okay, for my next magic trick, we will get rid of the thing inside there. So before I yank it out like a bad tooth, we'll just understand what happens. It's basically just a big crimp that grabs the wood on either side, and they put that in and expand it with a special tool. Well, what happens is if you try and tighten the output jack, or it gets pushed, or they just fail after a while. And once it's bent or mutilated in any way, shape, or form, you'll never get it back into the right sort of configuration. It never wants to grab the wood properly again. This is why we're getting this. At this point, there's not much else to do but grab it and yank it out of there like that. So you can see what that is. It starts out as like a big washer with sharp edges. They put it in the hole and they bend it so that it grabs the wood. And then once that happens, that's it. There's no going back. It doesn't grab the wood a second time. And if it gets twisted, that's usually what happens, is you try to tighten the actual jack itself and it tightens down on this guy, and then you keep turning and it spins in the wood and comes loose and dies. Let's put this in. So at this point, you've done away with the ability for the output jack to spin in the back, because there's no nut on the front. The insert is the nut. And I'm going to drill a couple little pillet holes in there and sink those screws. And that's that. And that's a happy device. Like I said, couple little strategically placed pillet holes. And we'll sink one screw before we do the other one. And then that way, we'll be sure the thing doesn't wander around on us as we're doing the other side. What do you think? What a concept. Nose just tightened right in there. Really good too. Nothing's gonna move. There you have it, folks. One electro socket. Alright. Neck reinstallation. Strings. And set up. This neck has the tilty function. We're going to make sure that it's not doing any tilting whatsoever, unless we have to. People go, what's the tilt function for? Just more adjustments. That's all. Just more adjustments, helping to compensate for inconsistencies in the manufacturing process. Oh, and then we had the debate about wood, replacing wood screws into holes that have already been made by wood screws. Okay, it's a tapered screw on there. Now, if you really want to be critical, I guess we'd want to take the screw out of that hole and mark exactly the hole it came out of. I just can't believe the thought process. When I put this screw into the hole that's already had the screw in it, and I push it in, and it stops, well, it's found the taper. That's it. It's gonna go right back in the same spot that old Johnny had her in the first time. So yeah, easy on the, you know, screw in and out. Yeah, if you crank them and strip them, yeah, you'll fuck them up. If you use the wrong screwdriver, you'll wreck the heads, yeah. But put the screw back in the hole it came out of, unless you're being abusive, it's just going to go right back in the hole it came out of. Come on, folks. Really? Really? Okay, so it's getting Ernie Balsack, regular Slinky, and you too can be a beta tester. prototype of our new groundbreaking string technology. Join a select group of players. Well, maybe I'll just do that. Ernie Ballsack. We're going to do the James Burton setup specifications today. And I guess if James Burton knows how a Telecaster's supposed to work, if anybody does, it's James Burton. I would pick him as one of the contenders who would absolutely know how to make a Telecaster go. And I had sort of got a chuckle. I saw someone chattering off about me cleaning out the adjustment screw with a broken off guitar string. And his comment was, get an air compressor or something like that. Or, you know, I have one. It's right under the bench. Air won't get that out. It's caked in. It's solid. And you shoot air at it, the air just bounces off. And to further that little bit of information, there's no air compressors in a hotel room. So if you find yourself in that situation, possibly as a professional musician, in need of adjusting your guitar. Yeah. I'm getting kind of excited, aren't you guys? There's James Burton in the house. If James Burton was in the house, the string action at the 17th fret would be set at 4 64s, 2 32s, or commonly known as a 16th of an inch. So we're just going to get that going. Mainly because it was pretty close before, but I got rid of the stupid tilt. Just because we could. What's that one? Isn't this exciting? Aren't you guys getting excited? I know I am. And always making sure that the bridge saddles are flat and not angry. Especially on this type, the string will slide down. And we'll just worry about getting these all close before we even bother retuning. Oh, hairs away. I'm just having a little look here. Making sure they're all nice and perpendicular to the guitar. Parallel, I guess, is the actual term. And will be a while. Yeah, so we sort of got that roughed in. It's real close, but now I want to get the neck relief right. We'll go back and check everything 100 times. And once again, let it sit overnight. Just sort of have a double check tomorrow after it settles down. Oh yeah, and this part. Things we never show in the movie. Dave stretching the living shit out of his strings. And you really can't stretch the plain ones too much. They'll just bust. because it's a plain wire. There's nothing to stretch. It'll pull a little bit here, and it might pull a little bit there, but not too much. Okay, so I'm not making this shit up. James Burton, neck relief, 12 thou. And I'm happy to represent that we're almost there. Just a little bit of truss rod tweaking. Is that the one I like? No, this is the one I like better. And I'm going to say that much. And I like to hold the last fret, and I like to hold the 17th fret, because that's sort of where the truss rod ends. You're not really going to get much usable curvature out of the neck in that little short space. Usually if you've got problems here, it's high frets. You can't get that going with the truss rod. But I'm pretty pleased with that. Well, I better put away my patented tool till next time. Till the next time I need an air compressor. All right. We've got a few more fingerprints there. So, gonna measure string height one more time. And we'll check the first fret action, which feels fine. I like I said, you can usually always tell if that isn't right. But Mr. Burton would like that to be a 20,000th of an inch. So we want to make sure the guitar is ready for when he shows up a little later. You know, we don't want him to look at it and go, who's this piece of shit belong to? Which reminds me of a story. Shall I tell a story? Dave, tell a story. Okay, years ago, a friend of mine, who I will not name, his band was opening up for Rick Derringer here in Toronto. And back in those days, we didn't really realize it, but after a while it sort of became evident that a lot of these guys would just pop up to Toronto and they would claim that their equipment got stopped at the border. There was never any equipment. Knowing that somehow they'd end up with something to play with, right? You know, opening bands would scramble club owners, promoters. There'd be some guitars and drums. They'd play, take the money, drive back to New York. So, they come to Toronto, and my buddy's band is opening up for them, and this has happened. There's no equipment, so, you know. Obviously, everybody offers up their stuff. It's Rick Derringer, for Christ's sake. So, my friend, who owns a black Stratocaster, you know, it's been, you know, been made aware of what's going on. So my friend goes up to Rick and says, you can use my black Strat if you want. And little known to him that Rick had already tried it out. And he said to my friend, you mean the black turkey? It was a black Stratocaster. Yeah, you can use my black turkey if you want. True story. Okay, Mr. Burton's pickup height is 3/32 and 5/64. Somebody was asking me about these. They're not hex keys. They're non-magnetic pieces of brass that are specific dimensions. So you can, instead of having to eyeball a measuring stick, You can just adjust things till. Till that works. And that one needs to come up too. And 564s is just a hair less than 332s, so when I get this, we'll just cheat it a hair. And I think that's the hair I wanted. Right there. Yeah, that's gonna be it. And now this guy. Once again, sitting on the low side for Mr. Burton. We'll level that up a bit. So I don't know, are you hating the long videos? It's just, you know, you just watch me twiddle a screwdriver for 20 minutes. Almost, that's too much. We'll call that. Every fret works as it should. Somewhat interesting what happened there. Oh, I see. It's you. The offending offender. There we go. Oh, and we can hear the old Peterson revving up in the background. Oh, and then somebody else was correcting my technique. Of course I hit it at the tone as well. This is just a movie, guys. You know, like when you watch a movie, and you go, wow. I'm actually, might get away without having to adjust any of these. I said that, now. See, I told you. We'll come back to that. This right angle cable is the best. I can do this now. Well, I like it. Oh, Mr. Burton's first fret action. He's loving 20 thou. And it's there, baby. James, wherever you are. I quit. Okay, American Telecaster James Burton specifications over and out.